This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everyone. Today we'll learn about Ewing's sarcoma. Okay, the ribbon is to denote the yellow is for sarcomas. Like you have a red ribbon for HIV, white ribbon for leukemia. Okay. So like that, yellow ribbon is for sarcomas. So to create awareness among public. Ewing sarcoma, it is the fourth most common primary malignancy of the bone. The first common is multiple myeloma. Next is osteosarcoma. Then chondrosarcoma. You can get entrance bits on these. The most common bone tumors is usually secondaries, but primary bone tumors most common is multiple myeloma, followed by osteosarcoma, chondrosarcoma, and then Ewing sarcoma. Ewing's is the most common in patients less than 30 years of age, and it is also common in 10 years of age. Usually Ewing sarcoma is confused with infection. So you should have a clear-cut diagnosis to diagnose Ewing sarcoma. So in young people, chances of Ewing sarcoma is more, and incidence is around 9% of primary malignancy of the bone, around less than 1 per million population. So Ewing sarcoma occurs in diaphysis of the long bones like femur, tibia, pelvis, and humerus. So these are most common sites. It can also occur in flat bones of shoulder or pelvic girdle. Rare sites are spine and small bones of hand and feet. Usually the patients are very young, 5 to 25 years old, and most of them are males, and it is rare in African population. Symptoms are: pain is the universal complaint, onset is insidious, it is of long duration, and progression is mild, intermittent, tolerable pain to severe pain. So this all start with pain, but very insidious. There is a delay from symptom to diagnosis because it starts with vague symptoms. So usually the delay is around 15 weeks. Mild intermittent pain, and then the patient visiting doctor, it takes, and then the doctor to have a look at the patient and then come to a diagnosis, it takes around 19 weeks. Why? Because it is slightly misleading. The clinical picture is not like another bone tumor. It is little different. Why? Because this is a tumor which has a fever in clinical presentation. Okay, no other bone tumor, unless you get tumor lysis syndrome, you won't have fever. Otherwise, all tumors, they are usually they are not associated with fever. But Ewing sarcoma, patient has fever, erythema, swelling, and it mimics osteomyelitis. The first time you see a patient, you will think of osteomyelitis rather than Ewing sarcoma. It happens many times. So when you do a lab test also, blood test also, you have more increased WBC, increased ESR, increased CRP, increased LDH. So all point out towards infection, but you have to correlate. Radiological correlation is destructive lesions in the diaphysis, in the long bone, with onion skin periosteal reaction. We'll show you in the images. Onion skin reaction or onion peel appearance is seen in Ewing sarcoma in the diaphysis. So this you should not forget. Ewing sarcoma, onion peel appearance in diaphysis. So it is a non-specific destructive lesion in flat bones, and MRI is done to know the extent of the lesion and to know the extent of soft tissue involvement. Baseline X-ray chest and CT scan are mandatory because they are the most common sites for secondaries. So you can have a primary in the pelvis or in the femur shaft. So the tumor can involve the bone and it can spread to the adjacent soft tissue. So it has a bony extent and also soft tissue extent, which can be picked up in an MRI. You also should have a CT scan, chest and X-ray to know the secondaries. Bone scan is done to see most of the secondaries. Here you see an APN lateral view of the immature skeleton of left femur or left thigh with hip. So there is mottled osteolytic lesion with poorly marginated edges in the diaphysis of the bone. So you can note diaphysis is involved and periosteal reaction is like onion peels, like layers of onion. So that is called onion peel appearance. So Ewing sarcoma, onion peel appearance, very important. So that is called lamellated, that is layers of periosteal newborn formation. So that is the key diagnostic feature in the X-ray. Bone marrow aspirate can be taken for staging of tumor to rule out diffuse systemic disease. What they do is they take out the bone marrow aspirate and they like you have your COVID RT-PCR test, you can do an RT-PCR test to know the genetic transcripts. Okay, so in a study utilizing patients with normal morphology, they have detected this test. So a fusion transcript detection was associated with increased relapse. So you can predict in which patients you can have a repeat or the recurrence of the tumor. So coming to histology, for all tumors, histology is very important because histology plays the best role in diagnosing or confirming the diagnosis of a tumor. So in histology of Ewing sarcoma, you have sheets of uniform small blue cells. It is also called small round blue cell tumor. So there is decreased intercellular matrix, scanty cytoplasm, rounded nuclei, small punctate nucleoli, paraminosalicylic acid positive, PAS positive due to intracellular glycogen. So you have tumors which are PAS positive and PAS negative. This Ewing sarcoma is PAS positive and reticulin negative. So as I told you, onion peel appearance is most important in Ewing. Similarly, CD99, you should not forget. CD99 is a cell membrane protein. It is a surface marker for Ewing sarcoma. You can get a immunofluorescence testing done for the histological sample. So it is specific for diagnosis. So, and also you have genetic test, the presence of P30 or P32, which is the MIC2 gene, which is present in X and Y chromosomes. Okay. So CD99 is the marker for Ewing sarcoma. So there are other differential diagnosis. PAS positive and reticulin negative is the Ewing's, but if PAS is negative, that is no intracellular glycogen, and reticulin is positive, CD99 is for Ewing's, CD10 is for lymphoma. Embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma, Desmin is positive, myoglobin is positive, and muscle specific actin is positive. In hemangiopericytoma, factor 8 is positive. In small cell metastatic carcinoma and melanoma, cytokeratin is positive. In other small round cell variant of osteosarcoma, osteoid formation or bone formation is present. So why are we worried about all these? Because all these tumors are differential diagnosis for Ewing's, They are differential diagnosed for small round blue cell tumors. So these are all histological differential diagnosis. So you can have a similar picture in the histology, but you have to check for other features to come to a diagnosis. Like the most striking features are reticulin positive in lymphoma, myoglobin positive in rhabdomyosarcoma, factor 8 in hemangiopericytoma, cytokeratin in carcinoma and melanoma, and bone formation, osteoid formation in variant of osteosarcoma. So this is also an entrance bit. You have a most common translocation, that is T1122, where chromosome 11 and 22, there is translocation that occurs. So that is rearrangement of parts between two dissimilar chromosomes, that is non-homologous chromosomes. Okay. So how does prognosis depend? Prognosis depends on distant metastasis, constitutional symptoms, size of the primary lesion, location of primary lesion, age and sex, secondary genetic alterations, and relapse. So coming to distant metastasis, so if you have a Ewing sarcoma of the femur and you have distant metastasis to lung, then there is a chance that it is a poor prognosis. In again, size of primary lesion, more the size, more is the tumor load. So you have a burden and increased morbidity and mortality. Location of the primary lesion. If it is accessible, you can do a complete treatment and then you can have less chances of recurrence. Whereas if it is in a spine where you can't remove everything, you have to remove only which is away from the neural structures, then you leave some tumor tissue behind and then there is a chance of recurrence. So prognosis is poor if the tumor is in inaccessible regions. Constitutional symptoms and more fever, more erythema, more inflammatory signs are present, and more the symptoms, probably more is the severity of the disease. And young age and males, they have a poor prognosis because it is common in them, and also younger the age and more the bigger the lesion, it is difficult. And secondary genetic alterations, already you have a genetic predisposition, the T1122, the CD99 markers, okay, which help in confirming, as well as they are also prognostic indicators. Also, if you have another mutation, then it is also adding up to the problem. And relapse, as I told you, all these factors and inaccessible regions, and sometimes you have to remove the tumor and also do a radiation. So what do you do for treatment? Tumor is extremely radio sensitive, so radiation can cure the Ewing sarcoma. So in large central unresectable tumors, you can give radiation, like in the spine. And radiation, if surgery causes unacceptable functional deficit. So like if you have a Ewing sarcoma of the spine, you need to, whatever you can do with surgery, you have to do, and then the remaining part you can give radiation. As I told you, surgery in small accessible lesions, wide resection is effective and decreases the local recurrence to less than 10%. Adjuvant radiation after following surgeries, like marginal resection or contaminated wide resection. So after surgery, you can do a adjuvant radiation. The tumor is radio sensitive. Coming to chemotherapy, there is neoadjuvant chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy. You can have both, and mainly to treat distant metastasis, which may or may not be apparent. In all sarcomas, you have micrometastasis that can go to your lung. So always we have to give chemotherapy to prevent the growth in the lungs. By the time you diagnose, probably micrometastasis must have crossed the soft tissue and must have reached the lungs. So they are like microemboli, like tumor emboli, which are showering in the, which are showered into the lungs. So if you give a neoadjuvant chemotherapy and adjuvant chemotherapy, neoadjuvant is nothing but you give chemotherapy prior to surgery and then you continue after surgery. Adjuvant chemotherapy is you do a surgery first and then you give a chemotherapy after your surgery. So mainly it treats the distant metastasis, mainly the lungs. Chemotherapy, we give 6 to 9 months of alternating course of two chemotherapeutic regimens, that is vincristine, doxorubicin and cyclophosphamide. Ifosfamide, etoposide and dactinomycin. Okay, newer drugs are topotecan and irinotecan, or both with alkylating agents in relapsed patients. Targeted therapy with anti-IGF antibody promises in refractory cases. Okay. So you have to, after treatment and neoadjuvant chemotherapy, so you reassess the tumor. So there is a decrease in the size of the tumor mass in the MRI and increased ossification in the radiograph. So your tumor load is decreased. And then now if it is resectable, then we perform surgery. That is wide resection is the common treatment. Here you can see an ill-defined tumor mass expanding in the medullary cavity, the whitish region you can see here. So this can be considered as a diaphysis, proximal part of the diaphysis in the proximal femur. Okay, it is expanding in the intramedullary cavity and there is cortical thickening. If you can see this side, thickness of the cortex is less, this side cortex is thickened. So this thickened cortex only with lamellated in the X-ray, lamellated periosteal reaction is the onion peel appearance. So tumor frequently permeates the cortex with the invasion of soft tissues. So once it invades soft tissues, it is a bad prognostic sign. Here you can see the cortex is thick. This is the intramedullary extent of the tumor and it can also extend into the surrounding soft tissue. So the 5-year survival rate is around 20% with local recurrence and 10% with relapse due to distant metastasis. So we must always discuss and explain the prognosis and long-term risk with the family. So this is a short presentation. So to summarize, Ewing sarcoma is the fourth common malignancy of the primary malignancy of the bone. Most common is the diaphysis of the bone. Young people, males are affected. Pain is a most common symptom. They start with pain. There is a delay in symptom diagnosis because it mimics osteomyelitis due to fever and swelling. Blood tests also mimic osteomyelitis. Radiologically, you have onion peel appearance, diaphyseal tumor, lytic tumor. Bone marrow aspirate has a prognostic value because it detects the fusion transcript. Histology, it is a small round blue cell tumor which is PAS positive and reticulin negative. CD99 positive, which is a differentiating factor from other small round cell tumors. T1122 is the common translocation that occurs, and more the number of lesions or bigger the size of the lesion, distant metastasis, location of primary lesion, they all affect the prognosis. It is radio sensitive. Usually small accessible regions you do surgery, for wider regions you do wide resection and also give adjuvant radiation. Chemotherapy can be given to decrease load tumor size, and then you reassess and restage and then do a surgery which is wide resection. So this specimen shows wide resection with the thickened cortex, intramedullary extension and soft tissue extension. So 10% can have distant metastasis, 20% can have recurrence. So I hope you all understood. Since we have time, I will also go through another presentation.
This conference will now be recorded.
So you have a Bankart fracture where inferior part of the glenoid is fractured. Usually it occurs in shoulder injuries, probably after a dislocation. You can also have associated fracture of the proximal humerus. Next is the Hill-Sachs fracture. Hill-Sachs fracture is the fracture in the humerus, posterolateral part. It also occurs due to dislocation. This is Holstein-Lewis fracture, which is the fracture of the lower one-third of the humerus associated with radial nerve palsy. So you can have a Holstein-Lewis fracture, which is the fracture as shown in the X-ray, where radial nerve is entrapped. So it is important to release the radial nerve from the fracture site and then do fixation like plating. Then you have Colles fracture, which you all know. Which is the distal radius fracture, which is extra-articular. It is due to fall on the outstretched hand. The displacements are lateral displacement, lateral shift, dorsal displacement, dorsal shift, and impaction and supination. So the opposites are for reduction. Smith is the reverse Colles fracture, where you have fracture of the distal radius where fragment is displaced volarly. In Colles you have dorsal displacement of the distal fragment. In Smith's fracture you have volar displacement of the distal fragment. Coming to Barton's fracture, it is an intra-articular fracture of the distal radius. It is called also called volar chip fracture or dorsal chip fracture, where the fragment or the chip takes away the carpal bones along with the fragment. So here you can see a volar chip taking away carpal bones from alignment. So it is sliding anteriorly. So the carpal bones along with the intra-articular fragment are sliding volarly. It is called volar bottom. If they are sliding dorsally, it is called dorsal bottom. Schaffer's fracture is the type of fracture in the radial styloid. Okay, where it is caused by compression or the scaphoid hits the distal end of radius when you do a forced ulnar deviation, causing radial styloid fracture. Usually seen in drivers who open the door forcefully of a car, and then you get a styloid fracture. So styloid fracture is, radial styloid fracture is Schaffer's fracture. Bennett's fracture is, Bennett's is also called Bennett's fracture dislocation, where the base of the first metacarpal is fractured. Okay, here is the carpometacarpal joint, and you have an intra-articular fracture, and part of it is dislocated. So fracture dislocation of first metacarpal. Rolando is comminuted intra-articular fracture. Okay, so here also you have a fracture in the base, but you have more than two pieces. Here you have only two pieces. Here, comminuted fracture. So that is Rolando. Bennett's and Rolando, they get, many of the people get confused. Single fracture line, Bennett fracture, both are intra-articular. Rolando fracture, more than one fracture line, comminuted. Boxer's fracture, okay. So usually by seeing the X-ray, we ask the patient whether he has hit the wall. So Boxer fracture are fractures of the neck of the fifth metacarpal. Okay, so by punching on the wall, usually they get fractured. SH laparoscopy fracture is a fracture when a patient falls on outstretched hand. You have an intraosseous membrane injury, and then you have a comminuted radial head fracture. Here the importance is, you should not remove the radial head early. You have to give time so that the distal radial ulnar joint heals, intraosseous membrane heals, and then you either remove or you can replace the radial head. Okay, so if you plan for an excision of the radial head early, what happens is, because of the distal radial ulnar injury and intraosseous membrane injury, the radius moves proximally and you have continuous pain for the patient. So you want to avoid that. So you want the distal radial ulnar joint to heal, and then you can do that. This is a Montegia fracture, where you have a proximal ulnar fracture with dislocated radial head. This is called Montegia fracture dislocation. This is Galesi fracture, which is fracture of distal shaft of the radius with disruption of the radial ulnar joint. This is called Hume fracture, which is a fracture of the olecranon associated with distal dislocation of radial head. It is a variant of Montegia fracture, Hume fracture. Night stick fracture, very commonly we come across, displays isolated fracture of the ulna. So whenever somebody is hitting with a stick, the natural defense mechanism is to protect our face by placing forearm against it. So then it hits the subcutaneous border of the ulna, that is the ulna. So it is subcutaneous bone, so it gets fractured. In cervical, you have Jefferson's fracture, which is the C1 vertebra, C1 Jefferson's fracture. So here you have a two-part or three-part fracture. The beauty of this fracture is that the fracture doesn't cause any neurological injury. You have to only immobilize for it to heal, because all the fracture fragments, it creates more space in the central this thing. Next, coming to hangman's fracture. So Jefferson's is C1, hangman's is C2. In an X-ray of cervical spine, the largest posterior spine is of the C2. So this is how you can identify a C2 vertebra. So in this neck, whichever has the largest posterior spinous process is the C2 vertebra. Here you can see a break here, so that is the hangman's fracture. Clay-Schwoebner's fracture is when forcefully, when the patient has extended hyper and then hyperflexed, forced hyperflexion, it causes fracture of the spinous process in the C6 or C7 vertebra. That is called Clay-Schwoebner's fracture. Holdsworth fracture is through the vertebral body, not so commonly asked. Chance fracture is commonly asked. Chance fracture is the flexion injury of the spine. Lumbar is more common. Lumbar, you have a fracture through the posterior elements of the vertebra. Okay. So this is the fracture in the vertebral body due to hyperflexion. You also have the fracture line extending into posterior. So this you all know in your ENT, Lefort fracture. Bumper fracture is a fracture of the lateral tibial condyle. Okay, the valgus force when it is applied, when there is valgus force while playing football or a road traffic injury, you can have a distal femur punching onto the lateral condyle of the tibia. Next is a Seguin's fracture, very important entrance bit. So in a plain X-ray, so you see the fibula, that is the lateral side, and this is the medial side. So towards the fibula is the lateral side. So you have an avulsion fracture attached to the lateral tibial condyle, so beneath the surface. So which is the indirect sign for an ACL injury. So anterior cruciate ligament injury, if it is torn, it is not seen in X-ray, but its indirect sign is the second fracture, which indicates probably the patient has a ACL injury. It's called a Pellegrini Stieda or Alfred Stieda fracture of the medial condyle of the MCL. So MCL avulsion kind of an injury. So Seguin's fracture is important for you. Pott's fracture is bimalleolar fracture. You can have lateral malleus and medial malleus fracture in an ankle. That is bimalleolar fracture. It is called Pott's fracture. When it is trimalleolar, where you have an extra posterior malleus, medial malleus, lateral malleus, and posterior malleus, that is called a trimalleolar fracture, also known as Cotton. So Cotton, trimalleolar fracture. Pott's is bimalleolar fracture. Dupuytren's fracture is a type of bimalleolar fracture, where you have lateral malleus and the talus is shifted. Lateral displacement of talus. Distal tibia fracture into the plafond is called Gosselin fracture. Bosworth fracture is a rare fracture of distal fibula with posterior dislocation of proximal fibular fragment. So it is almost like distal fibular fracture. Meissner fracture, it is like a Essex laparoscopy, where you have intraosseous membrane injury and then above you have a fibular fracture. If you take X-ray only of the ankle, you will miss the fracture above. So you have to, in all ankle injuries, don't focus only on the ankle but also at the below the knee joint, where you can miss such fractures. That is called Meissner fracture. This is Lefort fracture of the distal fibula, Runner's fracture or stress fracture of the fibula, Shepherd's fracture is the posterior process of the talus fracture. Very rarely we see, but we can pick up if we see the X-ray. Chopard's fracture dislocation in the mid-tarsal region, talonavicular and talocalcineo cuboid region. Lisfranc is the midfoot region. Okay, you have the most important here is the Lisfranc ligament, which is between the medial cuneiform and the medial cuneiform and second metatarsal. That is the Lisfranc ligament. March fracture or fatigue fracture, Jones fracture. In Boxer's fracture, you have neck of fifth metacarpal. In Jones fracture, you have base of fifth metatarsal. Whenever you have a head fracture, most commonly due to dislocation, and when you again relocate, you can find a head fracture, which is called femoral head pipkin fracture. Pipkin, there are four types of pipkin fractures: below the foveal ligamentum teres, above the fracture line, above the starting above the ligamentum teres, associated with neck fracture, and associated with acetabulum fractures. So because we had time, so we continued with the other presentation. So I hope you all understood. Try to prepare notes, see previous question papers, and if you have any doubts or any feedback, let us know. Thank you.